people normally get nervous when they don't have a piece of paper in front of them. They're fond of reading from pieces of paper, and the more senior or the more learned a scholar is, the more he reads. I get nervous when I have a piece of paper in front of me. I don't know, it's some reverse complex. But then I thought it would be only prudent, because I am the only person here in this room other than Amol Ghosh who can really claim to be at several miles distance from the subject of archaeology. So anyway, let me try at least to stick to the text. It's my singular honor to be present here as one of the few non-archaeologists who has summoned the courage to address such an august gathering of archaeologists, historians, and scholars. I mean it. Each one of you know the subject far better than I do, and I would therefore be the gainer if scholars present here could educate me further on some of the postulates, a little controversial, that I raise. And I'd be glad if they could rebut it. In fact, for provocation's sake, I had sent this to Professor Dilip Chakraborty in Cambridge, I had sent it to some others. He came back with very muted, certifications that you are on the right track. It doesn't give me that amount of fun if there's no conflict of ideas. I remember with fondness my long association with Caste from its very foundation day. For reasons that I'm ignorant of, I've been part of the family for many, many years as perhaps only non-archaeologist or non-historian. But although enthusiasm for a subject can help up to a point, and empathy with it can sustain one for a long time, they are ultimately poor substitutes for domain knowledge. I can see smiles. A compelling reason that has prompted me to be present here among you today is to test out some of the statements I have already hinted earlier that I have made in earlier gatherings where lesser number of archaeologists and historians have been present. So I have got away with it so far. Now that I have declared my agenda up front, let me visit the text theme of the seminar, text and archaeology. Presumably this juxtaposition of the artifact and the text, as it were, can only begin with the earliest literature of India, the Vedic corpus, whose chronological limits are supposed to be between 1500 to 1200 BCE and 500 BCE. Even this dates I had a lot of struggle. I have struggled as an ever-learning student of two disciplines, history, social history and social anthropology, with considerable difficulties as their methodologies are different. But one bias that I must admit is that I have more faith in the context than in the text. I am old enough to now pontificate. 62. It has been my experience that our textual narratives of India are usually prescriptive in their nature and are later mistaken to be historically descriptive. One of the most favorite one that I can quote here is Arthashastra. The difference between what was written as a prescriptive norm was often later been twisted and distorted into it was a descriptive of the state of affairs. It's not correct. As Kosambi put it, our recorders of knowledge usually followed the developments that and phenomenon that arose spontaneously from different cultures which enriched this country and confined their task mainly to the ornamental notation of these into texts or into bringing them into some sort of a canonical discipline. In other words, my submission after Kosambi is that textualists have often captured the ground realities rather than dominate them. They have fine-tuned the practices of the folk, whether it be folk dance into classical dance, whether it be folk forms into classical canonical disciplines, and have structured them. And in this process, they have sometimes led it on. But to completely reorient the thinking of a society on the basis of a text is very difficult to find here. In any case, we cannot dispense with the text either. I don't know how many arguments we used to have for how many number of years in Caste's premises on this very subject of text and context. An example that I would like to give is how folk memory has often been a better guide to old archaeological sites than formal texts. If you look back, Mohenjo-Daro, the mound of the dead, was there embedded in folk memory. It took us 4 millennia to find out what dead had died there. Rangamati is carries on as a folk name in Murshidabad and was later identified with Dr. Mrittika. Fancy name. I mean, I can go on. I am reminded of how a director of archaeology took me to the Bharatpur excavation in Bardhaman and said with emphasis that this is one place that does not have any folk memory. So your theory of folk containing the wisdom and text being some sort of superimposition does not stand good. I accepted defeat. As I said, I don't quarrel with historians. We went for a cup of tea on the village, in the village stall, seated on 5 slices of bamboo. As we sat there for my tea from those earthen cups, the chap who was serving us tea asked us politely where we were from. My usual lie that has actually stood me so well in all my field researches is that I'm a reporter. So that makes it much easier. Take out a pen, because otherwise it's very complicated. In fact, the CEO Prasar Bharati and all that, these appendages, I'll make it, I think I'll ban them. So I, as I said that we're reporters, then he asked which paper I had to mention and went on. Then they asked us, what were we doing digging up Bhutet Danga. So I looked at my honorable director of archaeology and he gulped on his tea. So that is one of my submissions as to which can be a better guide. You have to actually combine both. In fact, the Indian texts have often provided clues to archaeological evidence and the possibilities of finds. Some good examples I'm giving on the other side are Rennell and his 1783 memoir of a map of Hindustan, which identified Pataliputra with modern Patna. That's a good indication. We are not discounting the fact of folk memory there. I'm only admitting that he was also correct. Later, this was done on a grand scale by Alexander Cunningham, the first Director General of the Archaeological Survey of India, primarily, but though not exclusively, depending on the testimony of Chinese pilgrims and their travel accounts in his quest for the Buddhist sacred places of India. Fa Yen in Yun Sang, proceeded along the text. Note, the largest finds in India were made on the basis of foreign texts, not on the basis of our text. That's a PowerPoint of note. Cunningham succeeded in finding out the locations of many famous sites mentioned in these and then matched them with some Indian texts. Let us be fair to India. These records are, of course, had their own limitations, which resulted in all sorts of controversies, as for instance in the identification of Kapilavastu, because there was a wide field of speculation as to where exactly it was. Till today, it's not been sorted out. Nepal has claimed Tilaurakot as ancient Kapilavastu, while India has claimed Piprawa as our site. While it is true that freely occurring monastic seals of first centuries of the Christian era, which mention Kapilavastu Sangha, have been found in Piprahava, there is evidence to the contrary. So texts can also mislead. So there is another discounting factor. It is my sincere belief that the establishment of a linear history in India has been a uniquely daunting task. This is where I come to my main agenda. Worthy of special note, because it has to struggle relentlessly against the forces of overwhelming amnesia. Before the arrival and the recording of Islam, 1202 to 4 in Bengal, 1204, 5 in Delhi, a little earlier in Sindh, we have no linear history. I'm saying this with confidence before historians. there is no linear chronological sequencing of Indian history. Why did it happen? That's the sum and substance of what we get wrong. If you have a corpus of text which can beat the Library of Alexandria, why is there no linearity established? Is it part of a schema? It is a task every civilization had to discover a part of their own history through the spade. But to find and restore your own history completely on the basis of spade, accepting what had been recorded by forces that came in with foreign intellectual recording abilities. Islam came with that, the records of Persia and other civilizations. The English came with their own European gifts. What happened to India? It is a task of archaeologists and historians to reinstate parts of history from the hoary past in order to explain the journey with a sensible chronological sequencing. But where India was concerned, this struggle was considerably more than any other nation of the world. Without the dogged tenacity of generations of archaeologists, this battle would never have been won. And India would never have had the benefit of uncovering its long and proud past. Few nations have had to literally retrofit, we call it retrofit more than 90% of its known history. Much of this history had simply been deleted from our knowledge systems. Or if it existed, they did so in a vague, amorphous form until archaeology placed it on solid historical foundations. This is not just recalling history from the depths of amnesia. It is an incredible retrieval and very resuscitation of a nation's patrimony from the graveyards of memory. Let me add, along with archaeologists, the honor of uncovering our ancient Indian past, especially those millennia that antedate the historical era, should also be shared with geologists, because whom the prehistoric potential of most areas of Indian subcontinent came to be known by the early 20th century. If Cunningham had been the father of Indian archaeology, Robert Bruce Foote of the Geological Survey of India, in the same period, unearthed enough prehistoric antiquities from Chennai to Gujarat to be considered as a father of Indian prehistory. But more about that later. If it's really a fact that so much had to be discovered and rediscovered, then what one wonders what we had by way of our history when we began this expedition. To get to this, let us take ourselves back exactly 200 years ago to this date. We are standing on the 15th of November, 1813. If you take yourself back, you'll understand the sequencing, because now we take all the discoveries as some sort of a birthright of knowledge. On that date, on this date, 1813, November 15th, we had not the slightest idea of the real contribution of Ashoka Maurya. We had not developed any great pride in India's contribution to the development and spread of Buddhism. The entire period was obliterated from memory, except in snatches and in obscure texts, and of course located in most universities outside India. We had simply forgotten the exquisite art that arose out of the Buddhist caves, and we had forgotten it with so much vigor that we had not even a name for it. We had wiped it off our memory, so that when we stumbled upon it, we actually didn't, the British Madras Army did. But anyway, when India stumbled upon it, they had to fall back on the name of a nearby village called Ajanta. That is the Ajanta Caves for us. It took the British and Indians almost a century from then on to understand and appreciate its purport. So much was the paucity of our analytical systems that took us 80 years to get the hang of the first thing. And appreciate, and only then would we start claiming that it is this magnificent art of ours that had influenced more than a third of humanity through the Chinese grottos, the Central Asian paintings, Japanese and Korean. We to claim that almost a third of humanity was influenced by an art that we ourselves had completely forgotten. Some of the pundits have spoken about the historic University of Taxila. In fact, I have this thing that the first All India Service person, we call ourselves All India Service officers, was Chanakya. Came from Kanchipuram, studied in Takshila at least 2,000 miles away, kilometers away, and worked in the Bihar cadre in Patna. So people we had, though our people had were hardly aware of such esoteric information, we had no knowledge where exactly was the Takshila, nor did we know where the great temple of Bodh Gaya was. Bodh Gaya was frequented by Ceylonese and Burmese till the 15th, 16th century. So much was the loss of memory in exactly three, completely forgotten, had disappeared, despite the fact that I call it, it was a very basilica of the Vatican of Buddhism. The mighty stupas of yore had simply become ghostly ruins from which the poorest would steal bricks, and sometimes the railway and other officials also did it. Why blame the poor? And where you reduce to names like Dhongsho Stupa, Stupakar, Pachtupi, five stupas, Bilsa Tops, they were carried on in folk memory rather than in texts. It meant so little. And the majesty of Indian architecture and sculpted arts that one now observes with rapt attention at Sachi had little relevance for us in 1813. None of us knew it. Our history, we were told, in some storytelling form, had begun with the advent of the Aryans. But no one was even sure when it was. Even Max Müller provided us with an impossible range, wide range of Vedic literature, and is known to have admitted that there was no specific reason why the Rig Veda should not be dated around 3000. I had brought it down to 1200, 1500, 3000 BC. We were lulled into believing in the unchallenged superiority of some sort of a fair race. And we tried in some feeble manner to tell our white masters that we were now actually of European descent. That is the only good thing that happened in the middle part of the 19th century. But that we had lost our passports and visas en route. We could not even say where precisely we had come from this European homeland. You should go into Bal Gangadhar Tilak and others in that amount of literature if you want to go in. In fact, I think Asti could publish it with great service to humanity. How Orion and others are tied up with the Arctic. And I had to go through it all. Yeah. That we had forgotten our route. We had no memory in 1813 about the sheer grandeur of pre-Aryan Indus Valley or Harappan civilization that lay before us covered with thick layers of soil. It would take more than a century from this date, 15th November 1813, to barely uncover the top deposits, and another half a century of sustained efforts to make any sense out of Harappa. One would then succeed in pushing back the history of India by more than a millennia at least, 1 million at least, or even more if we take into account the early Harappan stage. That is no mean achievement. It is archaeologist's pen that did it, not the historian's pen. Because the moment we bring India's history to 2700 or 2600 BCE, we start rubbing shoulder with the ancient kingdoms of Egypt and Mesopotamia before Sargon of Akkad captured it. India beats the much-flaunted Minoan civilization of Crete and beats the Chinese civilization in terms of antiquity. That's another place where we've beaten them, is getting the Nobel Prize 99 years before. Everywhere else, we seem to be losing the race. Yes, 99 years before. We are referring to the phase that we reached after 1960s. So again, go back forth to 1813. So let us go back to 1813, 200 years ago when we had started. Yeah, my point is, if we had to retrofit so much of our historical knowledge backwards from the arrival of Islam in Delhi and in Bengal, Can we simply attribute it to an ahistorical culture of Indians? Before attempting an answer, let us run through some of the other dates of some critical archaeological discoveries. William Jones is the first name that comes to us, so we skip it. I don't want to discuss William Jones here. Asiatic Society. And we start with, let us say, Colin Mackenzie. Colonel Colin Mackenzie, he visited Amaravati in the Krishna Godavari belt in 1797, the first find of consequence. It is said that he heard stories of beautiful carved limestone slabs being taken off for a new city. Little did he realize that he was discovering the exquisite art, the stylistic form of Buddhism. There are three forms of stupas, the one that would influence Sri Lanka so profoundly, that he was discovering one of the three major stylistic forms, designs. Let us quickly recapitulate some of the other Buddhist monuments that were discovered in less than a century from Mackenzie's Amaravati. The next discovery was Manikala Stupa at Taxila by General Ventura. You'll notice it's colonels and generals, huh? Followed five years later by Cunningham's discovery of Dhameka Stupa. Takshila, the ancient city, the capital of King Amhi, who had actually witnessed Alexander's sweep into India. And a city from where we have several periods of history: pre-Mauryan, Mauryan, Indo-Greek, Kushan was finally discovered. Why was it lost in the first place? Cunningham also revealed the mighty stupa of Sarnath, which is more cylindrical than the other hemispherical ones, bringing up to completely new design. But Sanchi in 1851 was perhaps the most educative of our stupa sites. And here again we find the name was lost from memory. So much so that a nearby village would lend its name to the stupa. Again, like Ajanta. When one glances to the pages of James Ferguson's History of India about 40 years after this, 35 years after this, you will see the engravings, which are just ruins. Just ruins. There's nothing there. One would observe that a vague hemispherical mound was in ruins, and its Toranas and Vedikas that have been studied to no end were covered with vegetation all over. ASI's restoration has indeed done wonders, and we now be able to recognize each and every character from the Jataka tales of the Toranas that embellished the gateways. Cunningham's further discovery in 1862 were as important in the treatment of our historical amnesia. He identified Ramnagar as Ahichatra, Kosam as Kosambi, Sahit, Mahit as Shravasti, and so on. These jewels from our past dazzled, but they were discovered on the basis of textual evidence. So you have a very relevant topic getting into this for the next couple of days. Cunningham would then move on to Bharut Stupa. And this one was uprooted in true imperial style and transported to Calcutta's Indian Museum. Here it would serve as a classroom exhibit in educating generations of art historians, archaeologists, and connoisseurs. It is around this time that the first Indian of repute would be making his mark in Odisha. Because I'll be talking only of Cunningham and Ventura and others, the first Indian comes into the scene. I refer to Rajendra Lal Mitra. He had been schooled, remember, in the thought process with the uncanny eye, the excellence of recording in detail, as well as in superior analytical approach by none other than Cunningham. So the software was Cunningham's, remember. That is the simple point I'm making. You may pause here for a minute and wonder, what if the Orientalists had won the debate? We bleed when we talk of Macaulay. What if the Orientalists had won the debate? Would we be reinforcing the very roots of pre-modern, non-scientific temper that the then existing literature in Sanskrit, Arabic, and Persian represented? Would we be carrying on and reinforcing our amnesia with selective flashes of literature passing off as history? The much maligned Macaulay could do with a bit of objective treatment now that its 2 centuries have elapsed. I am not a protagonist of Macaulay. I'm speaking in his language, but never mind. Historians have to be objective. Nationalists can be anything. Thus, within 8 decades, the Buddhism that had died, quote-unquote, a natural death, was suddenly brought back to life from the graveyard of our memory and resuscitated in much of its pristine glory. These cultures and structures compensated somewhat for the apparent lack of tangible cultural heritage that stared blankly at us from the end of the Harappan period to the beginning of the early medieval or beginning of the Mahajanapada. So we find that the most brilliant phase of history, of our roots, Gangotri of Indian history, starting with the Aryans, had no material culture. Of course, that's not a fact, because we'll find material culture, but certainly no structures. I refer to what Abhida was saying, that we don't have much of, let us say, structural evidence in Bengal. I take that as a matter of pride. A structural evidence of imperial glory in whatever form represents a concentration of wealth in the hands of the ruling class, and that wealth comes not by voluntary donations but by extortion. Muslim rule, Islamic rule, as I pointed in my book, was very loose and lightly held, which explains its phenomenal popularity among the Bengali speaking people. It's a converse and obverse of the same side, that we don't have much of extractive wealth from which to build imarats. Within 8 decades, compensated. Excavations in the last 4 decades have more than made up for this deficiency. And evidence of material culture, even in the so-called Vedic and post-Vedic period, painted grey ware from 900 BC, red and black, black and red ware, northern black polished ware, they've come out. But as you can see, they show material civilization of a barely subsistence level of living. But okay, to be more correct, we have found in Indraprastha, we have found Rajghat in Varanasi, we have found, but they are nowhere matching where this was concerned until we come to the Mahajanapada phase. Rice catcher. Then I move on. Cunningham had the Buddhist edifices that Cunningham had unearthed with so much devotion and single-minded passion. Why had they crumbled into unrecognizable ruins? One explanation is that patronage had shifted to a revived, recharged Brahmanism. Is that enough? Some historians feel that Buddhist sites had continuing patronage from pilgrims from Ceylon, Thailand, etc., and therefore were other well off. If that had been so, why were so many generations of archaeologists required to unearth their wealth? There are feeble voices that are willing to listen to either tale, and I want these voices to come out strongly either way. But I try to harp once again as to why India had to wait for a Cunningham to reclaim its position of glory, of having exported the most significant intellectual and cultural gift to the world, Buddhism, the religion of peace. There are now scholars who are willing to pursue either vision. The cumulative effect of these discoveries was the reinforcement of national pride among a severely demoralized colonial subjects. This, coupled with the education system that comes in from the 3 universities in 1857, would produce an active national bourgeoisie, commercial middle class, that was looking for something to beat them back. And this was provided by the archaeologist's spade and the historian's analysis. That they came across pangs of anguish at the loss of self-respect that 150 years of British rule had inflicted upon India. In this context of instilled inferiority complex, that we may view afresh the impact of discovery of the lost glory of India, a subcontinent that was still fragmented and considerably confused as to whether it was one or many. The British never really tired of extolling their imperial grandeur before a country with no apparent history and heritage worth the name. And even an ode to an English skylark was hailed as the epitome of sheer poetry. We all had to read it. We were repeatedly told that we were an artificial nation that had been brought together by the British beyond it, strung together by their railway and postal networks, and united by their English language, and later bound together by All India Radio. The early stirrings of self-respect expressed themselves through shades of religion, as in Bankim Chandra or in Rajanarayan Bose, who emphasized in 1872 in Hindu Dharma Shrestata that it was religious life alone that could sustain unity in our march to nationhood. We would soon be able to disabuse ourselves and move towards a greater secular way. It also manifested itself through the reform of religions, Arya Samaj, Brahma Samaj, etc. Alan Octavian Hume, the first man who comes up to make mild petition, is described by Lord Dufferin as, he's clever but seems to have got a bee in his bonnet, 17th May, 1885. While the copious studies have been made of the caste character and class background of the early graduates of the universities who had the benefit of English education, O'Neill Seale, Broomfield, MacLean, and occasional sharp articles and literary outpourings have been linked to the new pride that the glory of old, restored glory of old India had now instilled, we would require more detailed research to sharpen the direct nexus between archaeological discoveries and national upsurge. This would require much more. Max Müller's phenomenal work, we can go on, but even Max Müller had now to control himself. At Oxford, having let loose the demons of Aryan pride and reinforced that the Brahmanical epitome of Aryanism, he had to contain the emerging Frankenstein in his essay of 1888. He literally screamed that the blackest of Hindus, he meant Indians anyway, represents an earlier stage of Aryan speech and thought than the fairest of Scandinavians. He was getting into very dangerous territory. But then why had the English to discuss? I am not putting Max Müller as English, but I am referring to his period in Oxford when he was part of the imperial scheme. Why did the English have to rediscover our grandeur for us? Bits and pieces of rediscovery are understandable, even in a whole phase. But it certainly, is it not strange that the entire period of Indian history preceding the arrival of Islam had to be, and prehistory had to be dug up by foreigners? A genius like Princep could decipher Kharoshthi and Brahmi. I'm just reminded of B.N. Mukherjee now. H. Dani, I don't know what's going to happen. There are no more, we can't, I tried my best in education, as education secretary and as culture secretary to put in some incentive. Kapila Vatsayan did. I don't know what's going to happen. That is gone. B.N. Mukherjee is gone. Who's going to? Okay. We have touched upon the momentous discoveries of Ajanta, and then I'll just tell you how it was, how the entire sequence would come up through phases. It was not automatic. You press the button, you know it. Nothing of the sort. 1819, it was discovered. It went totally unnoticed in our Indian system. Where, who would appreciate? The Hindu college was not yet established. It was just about to come up. And then Ferguson published it along with some sketches in a journal of the Asiatic Society in 1846, unnoticed. Gill of Madras University, Madras Army copied dozens and dozens of sketches. All of them were destroyed in 1866, barring just five. John Griffith of the JJ School of Art, Bombay, prepared 5 or 6 years, I don't know, art students, maybe 7 years of copious drawings. They were sent to Victoria and Albert Museum, and all of them were destroyed, almost all. It was a jinx about Ajanta, and ultimately, the first 159 plates would be published in 1896, at the end of the century, and reach India in 1900, almost one century. If one looks at Bodh Gaya, one would realize how much superhuman, if not supernatural, energy would be required to cover up a notable structure with a tall spire with tons of earth. As the Basilica of the Vatican of Buddhism, it is an obvious symbol of defiance that required more than the forces of nature to obliterate. That is my submission. It required much more than the forces of nature. The reports of Begler, Buchanan, and Cunningham give ample testimony to my postulate. And if the same logic is extended to other magnificent structures of Buddhism, then that went underground, so to say, our perception of a tolerant history would be rudely shaken. My singular point is archaeology had to dig out what the dominant religion and discourse in society sought to cover. But let us move on. I can then just touched upon it there in my paper about Upalavaram of foot and prehistory. But there again, I have a comment. The we and they continue amongst archaeologists and geologists, paleontologists and physical anthropologists. I tried desperately to bring all of them, the anthropological survey and the archaeological survey and others together. They met looking in different directions. And when I was going back frustrated, I looked at the Indian national symbol of whole lands, and I felt, yes, this represented something more than it. Four lions all looking in different directions. Very, very symbolic. We and they complex continues. Arikamedu on the western of the Coromandel coast, discovered only in 1945, few days ago. This is what the Roman link that Periplus, Strabo, Pliny, and Ptolemy had been complaining about, drainage of Roman gold, but there was no evidence. Before I conclude, I'd like to wrap up this long discourse that I've inflicted on you by focusing on my three postulates. It requires more than collective amnesia to forget or confuse more than 4 out of 5 millennia of India's history known to us so far. We had to await the arrival of imperial archaeologists to rescue us from the morass of subjectivity and to establish a definitive historical linearity. That selective memory of the Brahmanical classes, not the Brahmin alone, never mistake when I use the word class, we are as much compradors within the system as they are, ensured that much of what was inconvenient for our memory was simply deleted, aborted from the nation's memory scape. How else do you explain that when Alexander passes through, two Purans are being written in the Punjab, no mention of Alexander. No mention. It was only Megasthenes, Strabo, Aryan and others who would be restoring Alexander. As Shorindranath wrote in 1961, it is archaeology which more than anything else has helped India to rediscover itself, to win back, so to say, her lost identity. It will be appropriate to re-examine scientifically now and discount much of the intellectual baggage of ahistorical texts that had silenced or deleted large segments of India's past, since we can hardly claim a meaningful and coherent historical perspective from any of these texts. We need to pull aside the heavy curtains and usher in the light of truth and nothing else but hard facts, not succumb to programmed amnesia. Thank you.